A Retro Refresh Production.
Anybody else just see that Dreamcast move by itself? What the fuck?
Shenmue! An action-adventure game that's considered by many to be one of the standout titles on the Sega Dreamcast. Funny thing is that it was originally going to be made for the Sega Saturn, but God's a cunt and decided to instead release it on a console that I didn't own as a kid.
So why exactly is this considered to be one of the greatest Sega games in existence? I didn't know anyone that owned it back in the day. Mind you, I only knew one kid who owned a Dreamcast back then, and he was a total knob lolly. Eat shit and die, Nick.
The game was developed by a guy called Yu Suzuki. He was responsible for a bunch of successful arcade games such as OutRun and Hang-On. Apparently, he wanted to make a game that was a far larger experience for gamers. Big story. Big world. Big hair. It was even going to be based in the same world as that of Virtual Fighter, but for some reason they thought fuck it and made it its own entity. Many retro gamers would praise Shenmue as one of the greatest games ever, yet believe it or not, the game was actually a massive fail cake when it first released.
With all that in mind, the question is this game good or is it bad? I have no nostalgia for it, so maybe it's good that I go in with a completely unbiased opinion. Without further ado, let's fire it up. Luckily, you can also play it on the PS4. Oh yeah, so much better. Fuck it, let's just use a Dreamcast.
Why is everything making so much noise?
Anyway, at long last, we get the game started and get treated to this bizarre bit of story.
He shall appear from a far eastern land across the sea. A young man who has yet to know his potential.
Well, it all looks cool, but the hell is she talking about?
So our hero is called Ryo, and his daddy is getting his ass kicked for keeping secrets.
Hand over the mirror.
Wait, a mirror? He's gonna get killed over a crappy mirror. Well, Daddy gets murdered, Ryo gets upset, and then at last we actually get to play the game. And holy shit! He owns a Sega Saturn! This game is the tits! Any hoobs, Ryu sets out to find his father's murderer and get revenge. As you can see, the visuals are nice enough, and the music is fitting, but the controls... they're a bit meh.
Nothing really.
They ain't exactly bad, but they are far from amazing.
There really is a lot to this game, so I'm not going to overdo it by explaining every little bloody thing that happens. I'm just going to focus on the story and my favourite parts.
Each day in the game will start and end at the dojo. You can explore around the place a bit if you like and find the glorious Sega Saturn, which you can collect games for, Although you can only actually get Hang On and Space Harrier. It's not bad, though. You'll also find a ton of other crap hidden around indoors and stuff, so you gotta explore properly, so you don't miss out on anything important. Afterwards, you get to leave the dojo and head out into the town. On the way, you meet an annoying little girl and her cat.
I ain't a cat person, so I don't give two shits about the little furball.
While running around, you get thrown into a fucking side quest. Yippee. You gotta find someone's house, then blah 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 blah. I don't bloody care! Nearby there is a shop, and this is a bit I do care about.
You see, in the game, you can collect capsule toys, and they are all Sega characters.
I'll just buy one. I'll just buy one and all, you know, that's cool, just one. Oh, I'll buy another one. Yeah, I'll buy another one. Yeah. Oh, sweet. Look at that. Yeah, I'll just get another. And another. And another. And another. And a- Right, well, I'm poor. Blew all my money on toys.
Just like in real life.
So to continue the story, we gotta talk to some cunt called Yagmagashishishi-san. And learn the location of the black car that Daddy's killer was driving. The old git proves to be next to useless, so we end up in the town. This is a place you really want to familiarize yourself with. Check all the shops, learn what kind of people are where, and holy shit, an arcade! Okay, seriously now, back onto the story. Down the road, we find Ryo's best friend, Nozomi. She tells you that some prat with a stupid name may know about the black car. After talking to the very convincing Jamaican-Japanese hot dog guy, shit you not, that's what he's supposed to be.
Try asking Chinese people about Chinese.
Try asking Chinese people about Chinese. That's the dumbest fucking thing I've ever heard. Oi, Jet Li, you ever hear about Chow Mein? Thanks to dipshit, we gotta go and find Chinese people. Ah, now here we finally get to try one of the other features of this game. Quick time events. Once that crap's over with, we head over to the Chinese restaurant and the Three Blades. After talking to a bunch of Chinese people, we are then told to look for some fucking sailors instead.
It's at this point that the game starts to feel a bit dull. Just talking to random people and doing random shit and going to random places. It's... meh, really?
So once again, after talking to every prick in the game, we find out sailors hang out in bars. So we've got to head to a bar. After finding one and playing a game of pool, and ballsing it up,
missed.
We then head to the correct bar and get in another quick time event fight with this podgy bastard. Then we get told about some cunt called Charlie. Once again, I talk to everyone, including the fucking cat, looking for this guy, then giving up to go save my progress. At the dojo, we encounter Fuck You San. Great name, kid. And then head out in search of Charlie again. We learn that the prat has a tattoo and he's easier to find at night. After more running around and then beating up invisible ghosts in a car park.
Okay.
Soon it's night and we get a taste of real combat with a gang of Muppets. It ain't too hard, but you gotta be quick on the buttons and making sure you're facing the right way. After hearing about a tattoo parlor, we gotta call it a night. So after a lot of pissing around, we finally get to meet the elusive shit stain. The cunt tells us he will be meeting us tomorrow at 3. And as soon as we leave, the cutie Nozomi wants to have a chat. Yippee. The next day, we get given a letter that appeared right after Daddy snuffed it, and oh look, it's written in Chinese. Next, we end up in another fight with a gang of dipshits. This one seems a bit tougher than before, but it's still doable. Oh, and Charlie's there for a proper beating this time. It ends in some not-so-sensible soccer, and then we go hunting for someone who can read the bloody letter. The old lady at the antique shop helps out and tells us what the damn thing says.
If you ever need help, seek the aid of Master Chen.
Thanks to that, we know a guy called Chen could help us out. Sure, another missing persons case. That sounds fun. At least this time we get given a phone number for Chen, so I ain't gonna mess about. I'm just gonna phone him straight away.
Warehouse number 8.
Warehouse number 8?
You. Who are you?
Isn't this the Chen residence? Oops.
Well, at least I got another clue. Warehouse 8. I ain't seen any fucking warehouses!
Why don't you try looking in the phone book? The address might be listed.
Alright. The phone book.
I knew that.
And with the arrival of the bus, that is disc one finished.
You would think that we've actually just completed a huge chunk of the game. You'd be wrong. There's tons left. This is exactly why I am only focusing on the story in this video.
Back to the game, and we get into a fight with one of the most annoying fuckers in the entire game. Wish I could say that's the last we'll see of him, but no. On the plus side, he gives us the info to find where we want to go, and several bits of bullshit later, we end up finding Warehouse 8 and the old fossil Mr. Chen.
The mirror? The one that man stole?
It was stolen.
What is with the obsession over that damn mirror? I mean, when has a mirror ever been important in a story? Okay, beside that. Something that ain't Disney. Oh, fuck off. Anyway, now old Chenny boy reveals that there was a second mirror that Daddy's killer somehow missed. After this retarded revelation, we teleport back home and meet up with Fuck You Son again, and he tells us to head to the antique shop. There we are given what appears to be a part of a samurai sword. It's at this point that the whole fetch quest thing gets a bit ridiculous, so from this point on, I'll try to speed things up. Fight! Sword! Secret lair where Daddy kept his porn collection. Shelf. Scratches. Dig. The fucking Phoenix Mirror! Yippee! Well, at least things make sense now, right? But wait! The most annoying cunt in the entire game shows his dappy face and tries to nick the mirror. Luckily, he's as stupid as he is ugly, and the twit drops the mirror. After that, Chen refuses to help, and Ryo wants to go to Hong Kong and kick his daddy's killer in the dick 1,000 times.
Now I want to skip ahead a little bit, just to where we meet that prick from before for a second time. Basically, Ryo goes and gets himself a ticket to Hong Kong, and this cunt eats it!
See, I ain't even joking. The reason why I wanted to talk about this bit is because I fucking hate this fight. No matter how many times I try, I can't beat him. The only redeeming part is that you don't actually have to. It's okay to lose here. I have no idea if everyone else struggles this much on this fight, but I sure as shit got fed up with it. Anyway, after some more pissing around, we have to get a job. Yeah, because that's the kind of crap I want in my video games. So we become a forklift driver, and the tutorial is a pain in the ass. But on the plus side, I actually enjoy the forklift part of the game. It's really strange how much I like getting the boxes and trying to stack them perfectly at their proper destination, while trying to go as fast as possible to earn as much money as I can. There's also races, but they can be sort of stressful if you're just not in the right mood.
Anyway, normally I wouldn't do this, but seeing as the rest of the game is a load of go here and do this kind of crap, I'm just gonna skip right ahead to the final boss. Otherwise, I'm worried this video is just gonna get too damn long.
So take a guess at what the final boss is. Seriously, just take an educated guess. It's this cunt. I fucking hate this guy. His moves are stupidly strong, and it takes so much practice and time learning new moves just so you can beat this fuckface. It feels like it goes on forever. Well, finally, after too many attempts, I actually beat the prick, and we get to see Ryo bugger off to Hong Kong.
In conclusion, it is a great game, one that deserves to stand out in gaming history. Yeah, there's a few tedious bits. Go here, talk to him, do this. That fight's an absolute bastard. But despite these little annoying things, the game has so much variety that it truly is an awesome standout title for the Dreamcast.
Oh, like you would know.
Who said that?
Me. The one you always seem to forget about.
Why is my Dreamcast talking to me?
You never play with me. You treat me like I don't exist.
Seriously, why is my Dreamcast talking to me?
You actually prefer the Master System over me?
I'm not dreaming this shit. You can actually see this, right?
I'll make you pay for ignoring me.
Oh yeah? How are you gonna...
End.
Today's episode was sponsored by A Sexy Beast. Ah!